So in the last class, we have discussed about the effect of coupling capacitor in determining the bandwidth of any single stage amplifier. And we have also discussed about the bandwidth of a single stage common emitter amplifier and a single stage common base amplifier. And finally, we have proved that this common base amplifier provides a higher bandwidth as compared to the common emitter amplifier, because there is no such Miller magnification of the internal capacitor of the transistor. And in order to have the advantage of both the high gain and high bandwidth, what we have done is we have used a multi-stage kind of thing, using a common emitter configuration followed by a common base, which is known as a common emitter common base cascade combination, or in short, it is known as a cascode amplifier, which provides higher gain, and at the same time, it provides a higher input impedance and a large bandwidth. Now, apart from this common emitter and common base amplifier, we have another configuration left, which is known as a common collector or emitter follower circuit, for which you have already seen in the unit 3 of our course that this common collector amplifier provides unity gain. That means the V0 by Vs, that ratio, output by input, that ratio, voltage gain is ideally it should be 1, but practically it is something less than 1. It's like 0.95 to 0.98 within that range. And there is no phase reversal, unlike a common emitter amplifier. And at the same time, this common collector amplifier provides higher input impedance. Now, let us start today's discussion with the bandwidth calculation of a common collector amplifier. Now, let us start with very fundamental circuit of common collector. Now, we have a circuit like this. Common collector, so we must understand that this collector terminal is at constant potential, supply potential VCC. Now input is applied at the base terminal, and which is having a particular bias by means of this RB resistance over here. And we can provide the input signal through a coupling capacitor. So this is a coupling capacitor. We are providing input signal to the base of the transistor, and this emitter resistance RE will act as the output resistance in this case, and we are supposed to take the output from this terminal. So this particular diagram is a very fundamental one for a common collector stage. We have the collector terminal directly connected to the supply, power supply, so that it is at constant DC potential, or in the small signal equivalent circuit, it will be at AC ground or small signal ground. We have this resistance RB, which is there to provide a corresponding bias to the base emitter junction in order to make this junction in the forward bias. And the input is applied to the base terminal, and the output is obtained from the emitter terminal. Now, let us try to understand the small signal model. Already we have discussed the small signal model in the unit 3. Now, in this particular unit, we would like to incorporate the transistor internal capacitance in order to find out the effect of those capacitors in controlling the bandwidth of this common collector amplifier. Now, as you know, initially we have between base to emitter, we have this resistance R pi. Intentionally, I have drawn like this because base is at the input side and emitter is at the output side. So between base to emitter, we have this RPi resistance. Now this resistance RB will be there between base to ground, because one terminal of this RB is connected to the base terminal, and the other point of RB is connected to supply, power supply, which is essentially at constant DC. So it is at AC ground, small signal ground. So this terminal will be at AC ground, RB. Now between collector to emitter, we have a small signal current source over here. So collector is at AC ground, just like this. Apart from that, we have to incorporate this RE, this emitter resistance, which is in between the emitter terminal to ground. So this RE will act as output resistance over here. And we are supposed to apply the input signal at this point. Now at very high frequency, I can assume that this coupling capacitor is acting as a short circuit. So I can directly connect the signal source at the base terminal, which is being applied between the base to ground. So this is VS. And we are supposed to get the output from this terminal. So in the last unit, in unit 3, we have already seen that the voltage gain provided by this common collector amplifier is essentially less than 1 and close to 1. Now, in order to have, I can write that this V0 by VS, that ratio for a common collector amplifier, this AV, typical value, mod of this is close to 1, but it is basically the value is less than 1. Say for example, the value is like 0.95, for example. So the value is 0.95 and there is no phase reversal. Between input to output, there is no phase reversal. So V0 by VS, that ratio is positive. Now we would like to have the impact of the different capacitors which are there in controlling the bandwidth of this common collector stage. Now already we know that there are two capacitors, one between base to emitter. So one capacitor is connected for any transistor. There are two PN junction, one between base to emitter and the other between the base to collector. So accordingly, we have to put the two internal capacitors in place. So one is between this point and this point. Which is known to be our good old CPI or CBE, and the second capacitor is between base to collector, which is known as C mu. Now, as you know here, for this particular circuit, the collector terminal is essentially at AC ground. It is at VCC, so AC ground. So instead of connecting between the base to collector, I can safely connect the other capacitor between base to ground, which is nothing but C mu. So we have two capacitors over here. One is between base to emitter, and the second one is between base to collector. Now for this particular circuit, as you understand, base terminal is the input terminal and emitter terminal is the output terminal. So unlike a common base amplifier, here we have to incorporate the Miller effect. Now in case of common emitter amplifier, you have seen that the Miller effect was imposed on the base collector capacitor, that is C mu, because base terminal was the input terminal for common emitter amplifier and the collector terminal was the output terminal for the common emitter amplifier. But for common collector amplifier, this Miller effect has to be incorporated on CPI capacitor, because CPI is connected between base to emitter, where the base terminal is the input terminal and emitter terminal is the output terminal for a common collector amplifier. Moreover, we have RPi, this resistance RPi is also connected between the input and the output terminal. So we have to identify the Miller effect on these two components. One is RPI and second one is the CPI. Now, as you know, for any impedance Z, which is connected between the input terminal and the output terminal, the effective value of this Z effective from the Miller effect, it was given like Z upon 1 minus A, where A is the gain between the potential at this point and the potential at that point. So here, this gain is nothing but V naught by Vs, so which is nothing but the voltage gain of a common collector amplifier, which we have initially assumed to be 0.95, which is very close to 1 for a common collector amplifier. And remember, unlike a common emitter amplifier, this gain is not negative. So there is no phase reversal. The gain is not negative and the value is close to 1, but less than 1. So the effective value of the impedance is given by Z upon 1 minus A. Now, if I want to draw the input RC circuit over here to identify the effect of these impedances, so RB must be there between base to ground or base to collector. That is fine. There is no problem with RB. We must have this C mu, which is connected between the base to ground. So this is connected over here, C mu. Now you have to incorporate the effect of R pi and C pi. So effectively, this is connected over here. So let me write like this, R pi effective. And accordingly, we have to connect the effective value of C pi. CPI effective. Now, what will be RPI effective? So RPI effective, the effective value of the resistance will be nothing but the actual value of RPI upon 1 minus A. And what will be the CPI effective? CPI effective will be 1 minus A times C pi effective, because the reactance of any capacitor is inversely proportional to the capacitance value. X of C is equal to 1 upon X of C is equal to 1 upon J omega C, as you already know. So C pi effective will be 1 minus A times C pi effective, and R pi effective will be R pi upon 1 minus A. So what will be the total capacitance? So the total capacitance CT, looking at the input side, will be nothing but C mu plus C pi effective, because both of them are connected in shunt path. So as a matter of fact, the effective or equivalent capacitance is nothing but their summation. And what will be the value of the effective resistance over here? So if I write it to be like RT, so this RT is nothing but RB parallel R pi upon 1 minus A. So obviously, the parallel combination is governed by the minimum of these two. Now, as you know, normally the R pi to be in the range of few, say, tens of kilo ohms or so for this particular case. And if I assume that R pi is to be like, say, 2.5 kilo ohms, if R pi is to 2.5 kilo ohms, and assuming that A to be 0.95, then the R pi effective will be, so let me go to the next slide. So this R pi effective will be 2.5 kilo ohms divided by 0.05. So eventually, it is like, so 20 times of that, so 50 kilo ohms, close to 50 kilo ohms, 50 kilo ohms. And if I assume that RB to be, say, few hundreds of kilo ohms, say 100 kilo ohms, for example. So in that case, the effective value RT, which is nothing but RPi effective and parallel combination of RB is essentially governed by the lower value out of these two, which is equal to 50 kilo ohm. So I can safely assume that the overall resistance or the effective resistance of this combination is given by 50 kilo ohms. Now for BC547 transistor, we have already discussed in the last day. For BC547, the typical value for CPi is given by, say, 11 picofarad or 10 picofarad close to that, and CMU is close to, say, 1.5 picofarad. Now here, the effective capacitance CT is given by CMU plus 1 minus A times CPi. Now assuming that A to be 0.95, the gain of the common collector stage 0.95, then we find that the effective value of this capacitance CT is coming to be C mu. I can write like, say, 1.5 picofarad over here plus 1 minus A means 0.05 multiplied with 11 picofarad. So 11 into 0.05, that means if I assume to be like 0.05, so it will be close to picofarad. So 0.55. So 1.5 plus 0.55 picofarad. So it is close to 2 picofarad. So I can safely assume close to 2 picofarad. 2 picofarad or so. Now remember, for common emit amplifier, there was a Miller magnification because the gain was high, assuming that the gain to be 200. The common emitter gain, the voltage gain of the common emitter amplifier with 200. So there was a Miller magnification. So 200 multiplied with this. So 200 multiplied with CMU. So it was like 300 picofarad plus 11. So 311 picofarad. So CPi was like 311 picofarad. And the input resistance was like close to 2.5 kilo ohms. So accordingly, for a common emitter stage, you have already seen that for common emitter stage, the time constant, tau CE, the input time constant, was like close to, say, 717 nanosecond or so, which was coming like 2.5 kilo ohms multiplied with some 311 picofarad time constant. So R value, the input resistance of the common emitter amplifier, was governed by R in or R pi, and the effective capacitance was governed by the Miller magnified effect. So C pi plus 1 minus A times C mu, and assuming A to be minus 200, the value was close to 311 picofarad, the Miller, the total capacitance. And accordingly, the RC time constant was like close to 770 nanosecond or so for common emitter amplifier. Now let us see the scenario for a common collector amplifier. So for common collector amplifier, what we find is the input time constant tau in CC is given by RT. You have already seen it is to be 50 kilo ohms. So 50 kilo ohms multiplied with 2 picofarad. So kilo into pico, it will be nanosecond. So 15 to 100 nanosecond. So here we find that it is 100 nanosecond. So almost 8 times less. So if I assume for a common emitter amplifier, the input time constant was governed by the Miller magnified capacitance, this CPi plus 1 minus A times CMU. So it was like almost 300 picofarad because of very high value of the voltage gain over here. And we have an input resistance which was like 2.5 kilo ohms. So as a matter of fact, the effective time constant, the input time constant, is given by 800 nanosecond, close to 800 nanosecond. Whereas for a common collector amplifier, there is an enhancement of input resistance by 50 kilo ohms because there is a gain, because this RPi effective is larger than RPi. So it was like 50 kilo ohms, and the effective value of the capacitance was not that large. It was only 2 picofarad because this 1 minus A is multiplied with CPi, and the 1 minus A, this factor is less than 1. Typically, it is we have assumed here it is to be 0.05. So ideally, the value is like close to 2 picofarad. So accordingly, the input time constant is coming like 100 nanosecond. So as compared to 800 nanosecond, so here we find that the input time constant is 100 nanoseconds. So if I just want to have the corresponding expression between, or the relationship between the higher cutoff frequency and the time constant, as you know, this FH is inversely proportional to 1 upon tau in. It's inversely proportional to 1 upon tau in. That means if tau in is high, then FH will be less, and vice versa. So for a common collector amplifier, since the input time constant is less, so we must understand that FH CC, higher cutoff frequency resulting from the common collector amplifier, is larger as compared to FHCE. So FHCE was the higher cutoff frequency for a common emitter amplifier, and FHCC is the higher cutoff frequency for common collector amplifier. Now, assuming that the lower cutoff frequency FL, which is governed by the coupling capacitor, which we have seen in the last day, if I assume that this lower cutoff frequency is essentially constant, because it doesn't depend on the transistor internal capacitors, the transistor internal capacitance is having some say in controlling the higher cutoff frequency, and the overall bandwidth of any amplifier is given by the difference between the higher cutoff minus lower cutoff. So lower cutoff is typically pretty small, few tens of hertz or say hundreds of hertz within that, and higher cutoff frequency is typically few hundreds of kilohertz or so. So essentially the bandwidth is governed by this higher cutoff frequency, and here we find that if I assume that the lower cutoff frequency is essentially constant, which depends upon the coupling capacitor, so here the higher cutoff frequency for the common collector amplifier is large, and as a matter of fact, the common collector amplifier provides a higher bandwidth as compared to the common emitter amplifier. So if I once again want to compare these three different configurations, common collector, common base, and common emitter, we will find that the common emitter amplifier, although providing very high gain and moderate input impedance, but the corresponding bandwidth provided by this amplifier is not at all satisfactory. On the other hand, the common base amplifier, it doesn't provide any high input impedance. And as a matter of fact, we can also find that this common base amplifier in isolation, although it provides a very high gain, but whenever you make any attempt to connect the signal source with a common base amplifier, then because of the coupling loss, the effective value of the gain is reduced drastically. But we have one advantage out of this common base amplifier, that is, it provides a very high bandwidth over common emitter amplifier. On the other hand, for common collector amplifier, it doesn't provide a very high gain. In fact, there is an attenuation kind of thing, because the gain is less than one, like 0.95 or so. So whenever I say gain, I mean to say the voltage gain of the amplifier. Now, since the voltage gain is less than one, normally it is used as a buffer, a voltage buffer, this common collector amplifier, but it provides a very high input impedance, and the bandwidth provided by this common collector amplifier is also large as compared to the common emitter amplifier. Now, this is nothing but a comparative analysis between three different types of amplifier, three different configurations. So in last unit, in unit 3, we have already seen the effect of these three configuration on the input impedance and output impedance and on the voltage gain and current gain. And in this particular unit, since it is meant for the frequency response characteristics, now we have made some comparative analysis in terms of the bandwidth, where we must say that the common base and common collector provides higher gain, higher bandwidth as compared to the common emitter amplifier. Now, to have the advantage of high gain, high input impedance, and higher bandwidth, what we have done, we have connected the common emitter and common base in cascade to form a common to form a cascode amplifier, which we have discussed in the last thing. Now, apart from this, so far we have discussed about two different types of capacitors. One is the external capacitor, that is coupling capacitor, which is there to couple the input signal, the small signal to the input of the amplifier, or to couple for a multi-stage amplifier, to couple the output of the first stage to the input of the second stage. And the effect of the transistor internal capacitors, that means this common base to emitter capacitor and the base to collector capacitor, effect of C-pi and C-mu in controlling the cutoff frequency or in controlling the bandwidth of amplifier. Now, we have also noticed that this coupling capacitor, it acts like a high-pass filter, whereas this transistor internal capacitor, say, act as like a low-pass filter. So accordingly, for common collector, for coupling capacitor, we have to have this lower cutoff frequency. We have to find out the lower cutoff frequency, which is a function of the coupling capacitor. And for the transistor internal capacitors, we have to find out the higher cutoff frequency. Now, apart from these two different types of capacitors, we have also incorporated another capacitors that is known to be the bypass capacitor. We have already seen the bypass capacitor, whose sole impact is to bypass the small signal and to ensure that the DC condition is not at all hampered. So we have discussed already the effect of bypass capacitor. Now let us try to have the impact of this bypass capacitor on the frequency response characteristics of any small signal amplifier. Now here, let us try to discuss about single stage common emit amplifier. Let me draw a single stage common emit amplifier along with the bypass capacitor, the effect of bypass capacitor. Say, for example, we have a circuit like this. So this is the signal source. This is the power supply line in VCC. RC is there. Suppose this is RB. Suppose there is an dual pass supply plus VCC and minus VEE. So that's why even if this input signal VS is absent, this base emitter junction is already forward biased. So that's why we did not connect this RB to the VCC supply, because under zero signal condition, when VS was absent, the base to emitter potential is positive, and we have connected this bypass capacitor in shunt with the resistance RD. So you have already understood that the effect of this bypass capacitor will not be understood or will not be there during the DC analysis, because during the DC analysis, this bypass capacitor will act as open circuit, so the DC current will flow through this RD. However, during the AC analysis, during the small signal analysis, this bypass capacitor, the value of the bypass capacitor is selected in such a way that this particular point is, that means the emitter terminal is essentially at AC ground. So as a matter of fact, we can enhance the voltage gain to some extent. If I don't use this bypass capacitor over here, the voltage gain was given by minus RC upon RD, which is typically small as compared to GM times RC. To increase the voltage gain at the same time to maintain the stability of the circuit, we have connected this bypass capacitor in shunt with the resistance RE. Now let us try to understand the effect of this bypass capacitor on the frequency response of this type of amplifier. Now for this, we need to draw the equivalent small signal model. So to start with, we have signal source over here. Signal source over here. Then we have this resistance RB. Then this is the base terminal. Then between base to emitter, we must have the resistance RPi. RPi is there. So this is the VS. RPi is there between base to emitter. And emitter is not connected to ground directly. Rather, we have a combination, REC parallel combination. This point is at minus VE. That means this terminal is at constant potential. So in the AC equivalent circuit or small signal equivalent circuit, this point will be at AC ground, a small signal ground. And we have this bypass capacitor in shunt with that. So we have CE over here, we have RE over here, and this point is at AC ground. This is the emitter terminal. And between collector to emitter, we have GM times VPi, this current source, where VPi is that potential. And we need to incorporate RC over here, which is nothing but the output resistance or collector resistance RC. And we take the output from this terminal. So this is the simplest circuit or small signal equivalent circuit for this particular common emitter configuration. Now we have to represent this V naught by Vs as a function of this bypass capacitor to understand the effect of this bypass capacitor on the frequency response characteristics. Now let us mark the current that is flowing through this. Let this current is represented by, say, II, this current. This current is II, for example. That is the input current. So you have to identify the II as a function of this voltage and these impedances. So here, the effective impedance is nothing but R pi plus 1 plus beta times Re parallel CE, because there will be the resistance value over here, since the emitter is not connected to ground directly. So resistance reflection rule has to be applied. And accordingly, we can write the current that is flowing, II current, the small signal current, is nothing but the voltage over here, Vs. And what about the total impedance as seen by the small signal? The total impedance as seen by the small signal is given by Rb plus R pi plus 1 plus beta times Re parallel 1 by SCE. Re parallel 1 by SCE, because for the bypass capacitor CE, the corresponding impedance provided by this capacitor is nothing but 1 upon SCE. So this is basically I in the Laplace domain. So Rb plus R pi plus 1 plus beta times Re parallel 1 upon SCE. This is II. What about the output voltage? This output voltage V naught would have been represented by minus Gm V pi into Rc, as obvious. And what about V pi? So V pi is nothing but Ib times R pi. Ib times R pi. So Ib is nothing but II here. So if I assume that this current is Ib and this current is II, so same current is flowing through this. So I can write this to be II times R pi. Now with this, let us try to solve this expression. So V naught as a function of S, that means as a function of frequency, is represented by minus Gm Rc into V pi as a function of S. So this is nothing but minus Gm Rc, and in place of V pi, I can safely write IIS into R pi. So this is nothing but minus Gm Rc R pi into IIS. Now what is IIS? The current that is flowing is given by Vs upon Rb plus R pi plus 1 plus beta times Re in shunt with SCE. So we have two elements connected in shunt in parallel combination, Re, resistance Re, and the bypass capacitor C. So Re parallel 1 upon SCE. So we have a little bit mathematics over here. So let me complete the mathematical part. So Rb plus R pi plus 1 plus beta times. So I should write like Re into 1 upon SCE divided by Re plus 1 upon SCE. So which is equal to VSS upon Rb plus R pi plus 1 plus beta. Now if I multiply the numerator and the denominator with SCE, then it will become RE, then 1 plus SRDCE. Now that could have been further simplified to be, so VSS, if I multiply both the numerator and the denominator with 1 plus SRDCE, then it will be like RB plus R pi into 1 plus SRDCE plus 1 plus beta times RE. Now this could have been written like VSS 1 plus SRDCE, and in the denominator we have RB plus R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE. Along with that, we have RB plus R pi into S RE CE. Now, I would like to represent this particular expression in a form like this. So, VSS multiplied with 1 plus SRDCE, that is fine in the numerator side. And in the denominator side, what I can do, I can take this RB plus R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE common. So what is left? So RB plus R pi plus 1 plus beta RE is common. So if it is taken as common, then we have left with 1 plus S RE CE into RB plus R pi divided by RB plus R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE. So this is the complete expression for IIS. This is the complete expression for IIS. Now I have to put this expression over here in the expression for V0S. Then ultimately, we have got that VOS is given by minus GM times RC times R pi times IIS. Now, in place of IIS, what I can write? V, I think we have written like VSS, so it will be better to represent in terms of VS. So VOS is equal to minus GM times RC times R pi times VSS. So I am writing the expression for IIS. We have RB plus R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE multiplied with 1 plus SRDCE, and over here we have 1 plus SRDCE into RB plus R pi upon RB plus R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE. Now from that, we can easily find out the expression for gain, AVS, which is nothing but V0S upon VSS. So this is as apparent minus gm rc r pi upon rb plus r pi plus 1 plus beta times re. Then we have this expression 1 plus s r e c e. So the first part is not a function of the frequency, this part gm rc r pi upon rb plus r pi plus 1 plus beta times re. So this is not a function of frequency, rather the second part is a function of frequency. We have s term over here, s r e c e rb plus r pi upon rb plus r pi plus 1 plus beta times re. Now this APS, as you understand, this APS involves the bypass capacitor over here. And as a matter of fact, we have to identify the effect of this bypass capacitor on the frequency response of the gain of the amplifier. So accordingly, in this particular expression, we find that it is in this particular form. AVS in this particular form, we have some constant K outside, into 1 plus S tau 1 upon 1 plus S tau 2. But tau 1 and tau 2 are different time constant. One time constant is given by RDCE, and the second time constant is given by RDC multiplied with RB plus R pi upon RB plus R pi plus 1 plus beta times RD. So we have got two time constant, tau 1. Tau 1 is given by RDC, and the second time constant, tau 2, which is given by RDC into RB plus R pi divided by RB plus R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE. So accordingly, this particular transfer function involves both poles and zeros. Now accordingly, we need to find out the expression for gain at very low frequency and very high frequency. Now, as you understand from this expression, from this type, 1 plus S tau 1 upon 1 plus S tau 2, so the value of APS at H is equal to 0, that means at zero frequency, is basically given by K, this constant. And that is here minus gm rc r pi divided by rb plus r pi plus 1 plus beta times re. When s is equal to 0, this expression is evaluated to be k only. Now what happens when the frequency is very large? So if I assume that s approaching towards infinity, which is very large, then what is the value? Now accordingly, I have to divide both the numerator and denominator by s. So it will become like 1 by s plus tau 1 plus divided by 1 by s plus tau 2. So ultimately, it will become, this expression will become, k will be there. If I divide both the numerator and denominator by s, so it will become 1 by s plus tau 1 upon 1 by s plus tau 2. So at s to be infinite, so it will be nothing but tau 1 upon tau 2. So at very high frequency. So accordingly, the value over here, tau 1 upon tau 2, is given by rb plus r pi plus 1 plus beta times RE upon RB plus R pi. So this is the expression for tau 1 by tau 2. Now with this, I have to multiply K. So AVS at very high frequency is to be infinite is given by, if I put the value of K over here, I'll see that this value is coming like minus gm rc r pi divided by rb plus r pi only. So at low frequency, when s is equal to 0, very small, then the gain is given by gm rc r pi upon rb plus r pi plus 1 plus beta times re. And at very high frequency, the gain is minus GMRC R pi upon RB plus R pi. So from this, from the comparison of these two value, AVS at S is equal to zero and AVS at S is equal to infinite, you can understand that this particular behavior of the gain expression is nothing but a high pass nature, because at low frequency the gain is small and at very high frequency the gain is high. Because if I just compare these two expression, AVS at S is equal to zero and AVS at S is equal to infinite, we find that the numerator being the same, GMRC R pi, the denominator for S is equal to zero, we have RB plus R pi plus one plus beta times RE. Whereas for S is equal to infinite, it is only RB plus R pi. So since the denominator is less for S is equal to infinite or S tending towards infinite, so the value of AVS is larger at higher frequency as compared to zero frequency. So as a matter of fact, we have a high pass nature, a high pass behavior provided by this bypass capacitor, just like a coupling capacitor. It provides a high pass behavior, high pass nature with two cutoff frequency. So one at identified by tau 1 and the other identified by tau 2. So there are two different cutoff frequency. So as you have already seen, tau 1, if you just compare tau 1 and tau 2, you'll see that tau 1 is given by RE times CE and tau 2 is given by RE times CE into RB plus R pi upon RB plus R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE. So tau 2 is less here. Tau 1 is more as compared to tau 2. So from this expression, it is apparent that tau 1 is higher than tau 2. So as a matter of fact, the corresponding cutoff frequency, if I say it to be like FH1, so FH1 should be less than FH2. So accordingly, we can draw the expression, this entire thing in this way. So the expression can be plotted like this. So if this is the frequency and if this is the gain due to the bypass capacitor only, so asymptotically it will be something like that. We have two cutoff frequency, one here FH1 and another here FH2. So this FH1 is nothing but 1 by twice by tau 1 and FH2 is 1 by twice by tau 2. Since tau 1 is greater than tau 2 from this analysis, so FH1 must be less than FH2. Now accordingly, we can also find out these two gain. This gain is at very high frequency, AVS at S to be infinite. This is the gain, GMRC R pi upon RB plus R pi. This value is GMRC R pi upon RB plus R pi. And this value at pretty low frequency, this gain is given by GMRC R pi upon, let me check once again the expression, RB plus R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE. So RB plus R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE. So this is the mathematical part. So for bypass capacitor, it provides a nature of a high pass filter. So accordingly, for a high pass filter, this particular frequency is of great use, this FH2. This particular frequency, FH2. Because we understand that this bypass capacitor or the effect of the bypass capacitor could be neglected if the frequency operation is higher than FH2. Beyond FH2, we can assume that all the signal components will be passed without any attenuation. But before FH2, if I assume any frequency, any value of F which is less than FH2, we see that the gain is not constant. So the effect of bypass capacitor cannot be neglected for any frequency less than FH2. But for any frequency F higher than FH2, the effect of the bypass capacitor could have been neglected, in the sense that the bypass capacitor could have been assumed to be inactive for any frequency higher than FH2. Because in this case, the bypass capacitor will act as a short circuited path. However, some 1 by SC part will be there for any frequency f less than f is 2. So we have already seen that. So we have already seen that the effect of coupling capacitor and the effect of bypass capacitor, both of them, if I assume this to be f and this to be the gain versus frequency, so both of them, so this is for coupling capacitor, due to coupling capacitor, and for bypass capacitor, if I just draw the gain versus frequency, so it is something like that. So we have two cutoff frequencies over here, one over here, other one over here. However, so this is for the bypass capacitor, CE. And this is the F over here, F star, for example. So for bypass capacitor, we have two different cutoff frequency, one at F1, the other one at F2. And for coupling capacitor, we have only one cutoff frequency, F star. So the use of the bypass capacitor is not to degrade the frequency response characteristics of a common emitter amplifier. Rather, the sole purpose of the bypass capacitor is to make the emitter terminal at AC ground without hampering the frequency response characteristics. We have used bypass capacitor to ensure that the DC condition is not affected, because the capacitor will be acting as an open circuit during DC, so we can safely incorporate this emitter resistance, which can eventually enhance the DC stability of the circuit by incorporating or by connecting a resistance in series with the emitter terminal. And to ensure that the gain is not drastically reducing, so we have added the bypass capacitor in shunt with the emitter resistance, so that at signal frequency, this bypass capacitor will be acting like a short circuit and it will pass the signal, and the emitter terminal will be at AC ground. But our purpose is not to hamper the frequency response characteristics by incorporating the bypass capacitor. But we find that as we have connected a capacitor in the circuit, so obviously it is having its own frequency nature like this. So F1 to F2. So if I select the cutoff frequency, or if I select any frequency F which is higher than F2, then obviously there is no such problem. But if the frequency of operation F is chosen to be less than F2, so in that case, there will be the effect of bypass capacitor, which we cannot just neglect. On the other hand, the coupling capacitor is there, for which the cutoff frequency is selected to be F star. And if I select any value of F which is higher than F star, so the bypass capacitor, this coupling capacitor, will be acting as a short-circuited path. Now, to ensure that this bypass capacitor must not interact with the coupling, with the frequency response characteristics of the coupling capacitor, so we need to ensure that the F2 value should be less than F star. F2 value should be less than F star, so that any frequency higher than F star implies that it must be higher than F2. So accordingly, we have seen that the value of this F2 is essentially governed by tau 2. So if I just consider the value of tau 2 over here in this expression, the tau 2 is coming like REC into RB plus R pi. So let me write down the expression for tau 2. So it's a complicated expression. So if I write down the expression for tau 2, it is like REC into RB plus R pi upon RB plus R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE. So this is the expression for this tau 2. And this value of tau 2 essentially governs the higher cutoff frequency for this bypass capacitor, CE. So the expression looks something like that. Now, our objective is to make this cutoff frequency F2 to be small enough so that it must not interact with F star. For example, last day we have seen that we have calculated F star to be 8 hertz. Now here, let us assume that F star is, say, for example, it is like, say, 25 hertz, for example. What does it mean? If f star is equal to 25 hertz, that means if the signal frequency is higher than 25 hertz, then the coupling capacitor will act as a short-circuited path, and we have a constant gain beyond this 25 hertz. Now, if I select F2 to be less than 25 hertz, for example, if I select F2 to be 20 hertz or 15 hertz or so, so in that case, any value of F higher than 25 hertz automatically implies that F is higher than F2, because F2 is already less than F star or 25 hertz. That means this bypass capacitor must not interact with the frequency characteristics or frequency behavior due to the coupling capacitor. So our objective is to shift this cutoff frequency F2 towards the zero frequency. That is our objective, so that it must not interact with this coupling capacitor. Now, how to shift this cutoff frequency F2 over here? So to reduce the value of F2, what you need to do is that we have to increase the value of tau 2. We need to increase the value of tau 2 so that F2 can be minimized, because tau 2 and F2, they are inversely proportional to each other. Now, RE, RB, RPi, so we cannot control RPi. So beta is a property of the transistor itself. And RE is there both in the numerator as well as the denominator. And RB is must be there to provide a corresponding bias. So to increase the value of tau 2, to increase the value of this time constant, the only option which is there with our hand is to increase the value of the bypass capacitor, CE. So typically, to move this F2 to a very low value, tau 2 has to be reduced, tau 2 has to be increased, and this is done by selecting a very high value of CE. So typically, the value of CE is in the order of few hundreds of microfarads. So typically, the value of CE is in the order of, say, 470 microfarads or so, or 680 microfarads or so. So typically, the value of this bypass capacitor is in the order of hundreds of microfarads. On the other hand, if you just compare the value of coupling capacitor, so you will find that for any practical circuit, the value of the coupling capacitor is typically like 10 microfarads or so. So value of the coupling capacitor is small, only 10 microfarads, as compared to the value of the bypass capacitor. So bypass capacitor value is large, typically large, like 470 microfarad. So in order to making this bypass capacitor larger with respect to the coupling capacitor, we are ensuring that the tau 2, the time constant associated with this bypass capacitor, is large, and hence the corresponding cutoff frequency resulting from the frequency response characteristics is typically very small, and it must not interact with the coupling capacitor effect. And as a matter of fact, the bandwidth is preserved. Bandwidth is essentially governed, or the lower cutoff frequency essentially governed by this particular frequency F star. And already we have seen that the higher cutoff frequency is governed by the transistor internal capacitance. So once again, let me write down the expression for the bandwidth. So as you know, the bandwidth for an amplifier is given by the difference between the higher cutoff frequency and the lower cutoff frequency, FH minus FL. Now, FH is typically controlled by the capacitor C pi and C mu, which are nothing but the transistor internal capacitance. And we have already elaborated what is the impact of the C pi and C mu on three different configurations, CE, CB, and CC. And FL, this lower cutoff frequency, is typically governed by the coupling capacitor. And to some extent, if I incorporate the bypass capacitor in my circuit, then the bypass capacitor is also having some say in controlling the lower cutoff frequency. But to ensure that this bypass capacitor must not have any say in controlling the lower cutoff frequency, the value of this F2 is chosen to be typically small with respect to the cutoff frequency resulting from the coupling capacitor effect. And so eventually, this lower cutoff frequency is essentially governed by the coupling capacitor. And the overall bandwidth of the amplifier is essentially governed by FH, because the typical value of FL is very small, in the order of few tens of hertz or say hundreds of hertz maximum. whereas the higher cutoff frequency is typically large, in the order of few hundreds of kilohertz or even few megahertz or so, depending upon the configuration that you are using. And to some extent, there could have been some load capacitor which are there in shunt with the load resistance. And this load capacitor, in some exceptional scenario, it might be having some say on the cutoff frequency. For example, if I just have a circuit like this, the same circuit, say for example, we have considered circuit like this. Now here, the load side, suppose we have connected one resistance RL and we have also connected another capacitance CL. You have to understand the effect of this capacitor as well. So already we have seen the effect of the other externally connected capacitors like CC, CE and so. So this is the complete circuit. So you have to identify the effect of the external capacitors like CC, CE and CL and the internal capacitors like C pi and C mu. What will be the impact of this CL? So if I just observe this impact of CL from the output side, we have a circuit like this, or we have network like this. We have RL over here connected between the collector to the ground terminal. We have RC over here, which is also connected between the collector to the AC ground, because the other terminal of the resistance RC is connected to supply VCC. So in this AC equivalent circuit, it will be connected to collector to ground. And we have the another component CL, which is also there in shunt with RL and RC. So what will be the effective resistance? Effective resistance is given by R dashed. So this is nothing but RL shunt RC, RL parallel RC. This is the effective resistance. And the effective time constant, the output time constant, is governed by, apart from you must be having some C mu over here, as you know, because C mu is also there. So the effective value of C dashed, that is given by C mu plus CL. If I don't have any explicit load capacitor over here, so in that case, in the output side, we have only one capacitor, C mu capacitor, because you know, C mu is connected for a common emitter amplifier. C mu is connected between the base to collector. The effect is there. It is not connected externally, but the effect can be assumed between the base to collector, because we have a p-n junction between base to collector. Now, for a common emitter amplifier, one terminal is at the input side. That means if I just observe this one as a black box, so base terminal is the input terminal over here, base to emitter is input, and collector to emitter, we have the output. Now, between the base to collector, we have this CMU. CMU is connected between base to collector. So accordingly, we have to identify the effect of CMU both at the input side as well as at the output side. Input side, we have the Miller magnification. We have this 1 minus A times CMU plus C pi, which is the total capacitors, effective capacitance at the input side. And in the output side, we have seen that this is given by A minus 1 upon A times CMU. And for very large value of the gain, so this is typically close to CMU. So far, we have seen that the effective time constant, the output side, is governed by RC times CMU only. And since there is no Miller magnification, the value of this time constant is typically small. And as a matter of fact, this Miller magnification is not taking place. However, if I have another capacitor, load capacitor, in shunt with another load resistance RL, then the expression for the output time constant will be modified to some extent. And this output time constant is given by some R dashed into C dashed, R dashed C dashed time constant. Because we have this R dashed, which is nothing but the shunt of these two resistance, RL and RC, and C dashed has been increased by CL. So now if I select the value of CL to be large enough as compared to CMU, So in that case, this tau out may be having some say on selecting the higher cutoff frequency. Otherwise, this is typically selected, or this is typically governed by the input time constant, as we have already seen. And what about the effect? The effect is a low pass behavior, because this capacitor is connected in shunt path like this. So as you increase the frequency, what happens initially at very low frequency, this capacitor will provide, this capacitor CL, it will provide a corresponding reactance over here. At low frequency, the reactance will be there, but as you increase the frequency of operation, then at very high frequency, this capacitor will essentially act as a short circuit, and it will try to make this terminal to connect to ground. So the behavior here is a low pass behavior, just like an internal capacitor. So the behavior is something like that. At low frequency, the effect is there, and at very high frequency, when the capacitor reactance provided by this CL is small enough, because as you know, the reactance is given by 1 upon j omega CL over here. So if omega is very large, so in that case, this reactance is small, is reducing, and at very high frequency, the reactance could have been zero, and this terminal could have been connected to the ground. That means it is essentially acting as a short-circuited path. So at very high frequency, so the nature is something like that. At very high frequency, the gain drops down to zero. But this, you know, to ensure that this load capacitor having some say on selecting the cutoff frequency over here, if I assume that this cutoff frequency to be like FH, and if I assume that this load capacitor CL is having some say in controlling the higher cutoff frequency, then the value of the CL has to be large enough. So if the value of CL is large enough, so in that case, the overall time constant will be larger, and which will eventually move the higher cutoff frequency towards this side. And as a matter of fact, this coupling this load capacitor is having some say on the value of the cutoff frequency. So once again, let me summarize the effect of four different types of capacitors. So we have seen typically four different types of capacitors. So let me summarize in the next slide. So we have external capacitor, which are connected externally, and internal capacitor. And what about the effect? So external capacitor number one is coupling capacitor. Number two is bypass capacitor. So we normally let it, I think it will be better to write the name. External capacitor, which are connected externally to the circuit itself. So one is coupling capacitor, whose purpose is to couple the signal to the input of the amplifier, or to couple the, for a multi-stage amplifier, to couple the output of the first stage to the input of the second stage. Second one is the bypass capacitor, as we have seen, whose role has been discussed many a times, and sometimes we can have some load capacitor as well. So these are the externally connected capacitor to the amplifier circuit. And as far as internal capacitor, we have this, all the capacitors are junctional capacitor. So CBE or C pi, same thing. And second one is CBC or C mu. So these are the external and internal capacitors. Now let us try to identify what are the roles of this capacitor. So this coupling capacitor is essentially acting as a high pass filter. The coupling capacitor associated with the corresponding resistance, so they will act as a high pass filter, HPF. Same is true for the bypass capacitor, as we have already seen. That means essentially they govern the lower cutoff frequency of the frequency response. whereas the load capacitor will show a nature of low pass filter. On the other hand, these two capacitors is C pi and C mu, they have the effect of low pass filter. So once again, if I draw the behavior, gain versus frequency behavior, so eventually we have a nature like this. Accordingly, we have two cutoff frequency. One is known as the lower cutoff frequency FL. Second one is known as the higher cutoff frequency FH. Now, typically the lower cutoff frequency is governed. Bandwidth BW is given by the difference between FH and FL. Typically, the lower cutoff frequency is governed by the coupling capacitor, and we want that the coupling capacitor must govern the lower cutoff frequency. And you know, to ensure that the bypass capacitor must not interact with the lower cutoff frequency as provided by the coupling capacitor, so it is a normal practice to select a very high value of the bypass capacitor so as to move the corresponding cutoff frequency resulting from the bypass capacitor effect towards a very low value, so that the time constant is more, RCTC time constant is more, and the corresponding cutoff frequency is small, and this lower cutoff frequency is essentially governed by this coupling capacitor value. Secondly, the high pass, if I just consider this nature, this low pass nature, this low pass nature is essentially governed by these internal capacitors mostly, and you have already seen that this is governed by the input RC time constant, not by the output RC time constant. In some exceptional cases, which we have discussed right now, the higher cutoff frequency FH is may be governed by load capacitor. If I select the load capacitor value CL to be large enough, then in that case, by selecting a very high value of CL, the corresponding time constant could have been set larger. And as a matter of fact, FH can be set to be small, and which can to some extent control the higher cutoff frequency of this amplifier, and consequently it can also having some say in controlling the bandwidth of the amplifier. But essentially, in a nutshell, I can say that the higher cutoff frequency is governed by this internal capacitance C pi and C mu, their combination, and the lower cutoff frequency is essentially governed by the coupling capacitor. Now with this, the discussion on this frequency response characteristics of a single stage and multi-stage amplifier is completed, and then with this, let me conclude the discussion on unit 4.